Hello and welcome to this Design Cuts video tutorial, and today we're looking at creating masks in Photoshop. Now I hope by the end of this video that you'll be confident enough, even if you've never used masks, to look at using them in your own work. As always, I'm going to be using some Design Cuts content in this video, so let's take a quick trip to the Design Cuts website and see what I'm using. I'll be using one floral image here from the Wild Floral Wonders pack by Denise Ann. I'll be using a texture image from the Ultimate Texture and Photography Kit and a couple of landscapes from the Landscape Watercolor Sketches pack. So let's head back to Photoshop. Now chances are, even if you've never used a mask before and you don't even know what it is, you've probably seen masks in Photoshop. The reason for this is that adjustment layers come with masks already applied to them. So let's have a look at this image. It's just a background layer and it's locked. And what I want to do is to recolor these flowers. I don't want pink flowers, I want yellow flowers. So to do this, I'm going to start by just making a selection of my flowers. And since they're pink and red, I'm going to use the color range tool. So I'll choose select and then color range. I've got my eyedropper selected here and I'm choosing sampled colors. So this allows me to sample a color in the image to select. Now I need more than just a single pink, so I'm going to click on the plus icon here and I'm just going to continue to click on these flowers until I've got pretty much all of the flowers selected. I'll click OK. And you can see the marching ants around the flowers. Now I'm going to change their color, and I'm going to do that with a hue saturation adjustment layer. So I'll choose layer, new adjustment layer, and then hue saturation. I'll click OK. In the layers palette here, you'll see that we've got a hue saturation adjustment layer and a layer mask with our selection already in place. So I'm going to double click on the hue saturation adjustment and let's go and change the color of the flowers. And as I walk this color around, you can see that the flowers are changing. Now I haven't made the world's best selection, so we're going to make a little bit of a fix to that in just a minute. But I'm going to make the flowers this sort of yellow color. So what this mask has allowed me to do is to limit my hue saturation adjustment to only the areas that I previously had selected. And this shows us very clearly what masks do. Where a mask is white, the effect that is on that layer, in other words, the recoloring of the flowers, is being applied. But where it's black, there is no recoloring. Now, if I disable this mask, I'm going to hold the Shift key as I click on the mask. This is what it would look like if I hadn't masked it. That hue saturation adjustment would have changed all the colors in the image. But I didn't want to change them all, I just wanted to change the flowers. So in using a mask like this one, we're able to limit the changes to just the area that we've selected. Now, as I said, there's a little bit of a problem here in this area. I probably didn't make my selection quite big enough. But you know what? I can fix it. I'm going to target the mask so it has this little border around it. I'm going to set white as my foreground color because that's the color we paint with. I'm going to the brush tool and I'm going to select a brush. So I'm going to choose a sort of round brush, but I'm going to decrease the hardness just a little bit so it's not quite as hard as it was. I'm going to use the open and close square bracket keys just to change the brush size. And then I'm going to come in here and I'm just going to paint on the image with white to add those areas to the mask. Now I'm not actually painting white paint on the image, I'm painting on the mask. So the way you operate with masks is you click on the mask so it gets this little border around it, and then you paint on the image where you want the mask to be affected. And so I'm just adding some missing areas into the mask, and that's applying that recolor effect to this part of the image. Now that we've got a mask in place, it's time to have a look at why we would even use these. Well, one of the reasons is that they're really good for editing, because if we use a mask to recolor the image, if we want to change the mask area, we can do that very easily. We can trash our mask, we can just drag it onto the trash can to get rid of it. We can also edit the mask at any time. We can paint on it with black or white to add or remove areas from the effect of this hue saturation adjustment layer. As a designer, being able to use a mask will give you a lot of flexibility in the designs that you create and make them a little bit more editable. So if somebody changes their mind or you decide that you don't like something, it's going to be very easy to remove the effect. So there's a mask used with an adjustment layer. Let's have a look at a mask used in a different circumstance. Here we have another one of these painted landscapes. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to apply a filter to a duplicate of this image. So over here in the layers palette, I'm just going to drag and drop the background onto the new layer icon, and that creates a second layer. The two layers are identical, so we're having no effect right now on the image. But I'm going to apply a filter to this image. But before I do, I'm just noticing here that my colors are pink and white. The kind of filter that I'm about to apply uses the foreground and background colors as part of that filter. So if I don't want things to look pink and white, I need to make a change before I open the filter gallery. And the change I'm going to make is to set the default colors black and white. Now, filters can be applied in an editable way now in Photoshop. So with the topmost layer selected, I'm first going to choose filter and then convert for smart filters. This will convert the layer to a smart object, which means that I'll be able to edit the filter if I don't like it or if I need to change it. So with that layer selected, I'm going to choose filter and then filter gallery. I'm just going to resize my preview so I can see my entire tree. And I'm going to use this charcoal filter. I've already got it selected here. It's in the sketch group of objects, but you'll see that most of the filters in this particular group of filters, again, uses this black and white. So you always want to make sure that you choose your right colors before you come in and use the filter, or you're going to have colors that you didn't expect or want to use. So I'm just going to increase my charcoal thickness a bit and maybe just adjust the balance here between light and dark. If I'm happy, I'll just click OK. So now I have my landscape with the filter applied to it on top of the original watercolor. And what I want to do is blend these two together. So I want to get the effect of a sort of charcoal-y sketch moving into a full color watercolor background. Well, you'll see that by using smart filters, Photoshop has already given me a layer mask. This is the layer mask for the filter. So what I want to do is to create a transition across this filter. And to do that, I'm going to use a gradient. Because on layer masks, you can paint with black or white or shades of gray. If you use black or white, you'll either fully remove or fully add the effect. If you use shades of gray, you're going to get a transitional effect, a sort of partially transparent effect. So with the gradient tool selected, I'm just going to click here on the gradients. And the one I want is this first one. It's just the foreground to background gradient. So I'll just click OK. I want it to be a linear gradient. So that's the first one here that is already selected. I'll click on my layer mask because I don't want to dump this gradient onto my painting. I want to dump it onto the mask. So I'm just going to make sure the mask is selected and I'm just going to drag across the image. If I hold the shift key, I'm going to make sure I drag in a perfectly horizontal line. And everything's gone the wrong way. I wanted my charcoal on the left and my watercolor painting on the right. So what I'm going to do is to reverse the gradient. I'm going to do it all over again. Again, just making sure that that mask is selected. I'm just going to hold shift as I draw across the image. And this is the effect that I was looking for, this partial transition from a charcoal sketch on the left through to a painted background on the right. And it's this transition where it's white, I'm seeing the charcoal sketch, where it's black, I'm seeing the painted layer underneath, and where it's this sort of transitional gray scale in the middle, I'm seeing a sort of seamless blend of those two effects. So masks can be used to blend two images into each other. But this is not a sort of permanent blend because this is a filter and this is a smart object. So if I double click on the filter gallery, I can reopen the filter. And if I don't like the filter settings, for example, then I can change them. I can make it thicker. I can change the dark light balance. I could even change to a totally different filter. And then click OK and the effect is still in place. It's just a different filter applied. But the whole effect was fully editable because I used a layer mask to do the transition. So let's have a look at another example, and this is one of those floral images. Now, in this case, I'm going to show you how you can use a mask to operate like a sort of removable eraser. So I've got a layer here and it doesn't actually have a mask on it. So for me to add a mask, I can just click here on the Add Layer Mask icon, and that just adds a layer mask. It doesn't do anything to the image because it's white. But if we paint on the image in black, it's going to change the image. So here, this transparent PNG file is on top of a white layer. So what I'm going to do is use the mask to erase this piece here. So with the mask selected, I'm going to make sure that black is my foreground color because that's the color I paint with if I select a paintbrush. I'm going to select my brush. I still have that same brush selected, but in this case, I'm going to increase the hardness because I don't want any softness on it, because what I want to do is to totally erase this element. I'll adjust the size of the paintbrush and just paint over it. Now I'm painting on the mask, not on the image. You can see here, there's the mask. If I shift click on the mask, we can see the element come back. It's not actually been removed, it's just been hidden with the mask. So imagine if you had a really, really complex document and your client comes to and says, oh, I'm not really sure about that element, go and delete it. Well, if you just delete it or erase it and they decide they don't like that and you have to put it back again, then you're going to have to be recreating elements. But if you use a mask and they say, didn't really like that, go and put it back again, well, it's a one-click solution. You just shift-click on the mask and lo and behold, the element is replaced. Now, while this is a very simple example, it does go to show the power of using masks in place of things like the eraser tool. Masks just give you a whole lot more flexibility in your edits. Let's go now to an image which we worked on in a video where I was talking about using the pen tool in Photoshop, and in particular using the pen tool to make selections. So over here in the paths palette is a path, and it's a path that selects the car. I'm going to select the path with the path selection tool. Now let's go to the layers palette. Now the masks that we've looked at so far are what are called bitmap masks. They're black and white and grayscale bitmap images. But Photoshop can also create vector masks. So with our vector path selected, I'm going to hold down the Control key on the PC, Command on the Mac, and click the Add Layer Mask icon. And in this case, we're creating a vector mask rather than a bitmap mask. So here in the paths palette is the mask that goes with that layer. And if I click on the mask, I can select it and I can also edit it. So you can have masks that are bitmaps, but you can also have masks that are vector masks. Although probably most of the time you'll be using bitmap masks, just be aware that there is also a vector type of mask, and you get to it by pressing the Control or Command key as you create your mask. Now let's look at one final example. Here I have one of those textures from the Ultimate Texture Pack, and it's on top of just a photograph that I shot in Hong Kong. What I want to do is to blend these two images together. So I want to texturize my image partially because I want to get rid of this extremely ugly sky. So in other videos, we've looked at using blend modes to blend textures. So here I'm just going to drop down the blend mode list and select the first blend mode. I'm going to use the down arrow key to just toggle through the blend modes. On a Mac, I would choose a tool that's not a paintbrush tool, and I would use Shift Plus and Shift Minus. I'm going back because I want to use color burn. So this is the blend mode I want to use, but I'm going to drop down the opacity because I think 100% is too much. Now, in addition to using blend modes and reduced opacity to blend this layer into the one below, we can also use a mask. So with this layer selected, I'm just going to click to add a mask. And I'm going to paint on this mask to change how this texture is impacting the image below. Now to do that, I'm going to click the paintbrush tool and I'm going to go and get one of the texture brushes from that same texture pack. So I've got a texture brush selected and I'm going to the brushes palette here and I'm going to just adjust the spacing on this a bit. Let's go to shape dynamics and let's make it vary in size a bit and in angle and a bit in roundness. Let's go to scattering and let's have it scatter across both axes. and increase the count a bit. So we've got something that's going to paint as a nice sort of texture brush. So let's go back to our layers. I'm going to make sure that I have this layer mask selected. I have black selected as my paint color. And so now I'm going to paint on the image. And as I do, you can see that the texture is appearing in the mask. And what that's doing is partially removing this image from impacting the image below. But I'm sort of adding texture on texture, so I'm going to get a really subtle effect. If we want to see the mask, we already know that shift clicking on the mask hides it, but we can also alt or option click on the mask to see the mask. And this is the mask that we're creating. In fact, we can work on the mask just here. So this is the mask that we're seeing. We're actually working on the mask. And then when I click back on the layer here, we're seeing the effect of the mask that we just painted on the image. Now this mask is removable. If we decide we don't like it, we can just drag it onto the trash can, at which point we're asked whether we want to remove it, just delete it, or actually apply it to the image. If we apply it to the image, this mask area is going to be actually cut out of this image, so we're going to make a permanent change to it. If we just delete it, then the mask's just going to disappear and the layer is back to being a fully opaque image, but with these settings applied to it. In everyday terms, as a Photoshop user, masks are pretty much as complex as Photoshop's going to get. So if you can master the art of using layers and masks in creating your images, then there's practically nothing that Photoshop can throw at you that you won't be able to be the master of. I hope that you've enjoyed learning about masks in Photoshop. Please let us know what you think in the comments below and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed this tutorial. Until next time, I'm Helen Bradley for Design Cuts.